Good morning, everybody. Today, let us see some fundamental ideas of circular motion. We know that whenever a particle is moving in a closed path about a fixed point, such motion is called rotatory motion. Such motion is called rotatory motion. If the particle is rotating about the fixed point in a closed path at a fixed distance, such motion is considered as circular motion. Circular motion is a motion in which the particle is rotating about a fixed point in a closed path at a fixed distance. In order to study this circular motion, we will study it as horizontal circular motion and vertical circular motion. In kinematics, we generally deal with horizontal circular motion. So, on a particular plane, if a particle is rotating about a fixed point at a fixed distance or in a closed path, such a motion is considered as horizontal circular motion. And if you see the velocity vector, it is always tangential to the path followed by the particle. Wherever you consider, that velocity vector is tangential. So, magnitude wise, the velocity vector is not going to change its value, but direction wise, it is continuously changing its value. So, whenever there is a change in velocity associated with respect to time, it leads to the development of certain acceleration, and we are able to prove that acceleration is towards the center. Such an acceleration is called centripetal acceleration. Centripetal acceleration can have a formula v square by r. And you know that the relationship between v and r is nothing but v is equal to r omega. Omega is the angular velocity with which the particle is rotating or executing circular motion. And if you substitute r omega here, the centripetal acceleration, which is acting towards the center of the circle, is given by r omega square. This centripetal acceleration leads to give some force. This is centripetal acceleration. It leads to the development of certain force called centripetal force. Force is generally given by mass into acceleration. So you can write mr omega square over mv square by r. These formulas are applicable only in case of uniform circular motion. Uniform circular motion means the circular motion in which the magnitude of velocity is fixed, linear velocity is fixed, and the direction of velocity is going to change continuously from time to time, leads to the development of certain acceleration towards the center of the circle called centripetal acceleration, and it leads to the development of certain force called centripetal force, which is given by mv square by r. In order to balance the particle at this particular position, there is a need of pseudo force here. The pseudo force or virtual force which is balancing the centripetal force to keep the particle on the fixed circular path is called centrifugal force. So whenever a particle is executing uniform circular motion, it is acted upon by two forces. One force towards the center called centripetal force. One force away from the center is called centrifugal force. Magnitude wise, centripetal force and centrifugal force both are having same value. Direction wise, both are opposite to one another. The purpose of centrifugal force is to counterbalance the centripetal force to keep the particle at equilibrium and to make the particle to move on the fixed circular path. So, the magnitude of centrifugal force is also given by the same expression, mv square by r. But it is a real force, it's a pseudo force. We will discuss about the concept of pseudo force in laws of motion chapter. For time being, the important points you should remember related to uniform circular motion are: the first one, whenever the magnitude of linear velocity is fixed in a circular motion, such a circular motion is considered as uniform circular motion. In uniform circular motion, there exists an acceleration towards the center of the circle called centripetal acceleration, and whose value is found as r omega square r v square by r, and where omega is the angular velocity and the centripetal force is counterbalanced by some other force called centrifugal force, which is a pseudo force. You can imagine like that. It acts as exactly opposing force to keep the particle to move on the fixed circular orbit. We are imagining this force. This virtual force is having magnitude exactly equal to centripetal force, and whose equation is given by mr omega square r mv square by r. Here omega is nothing but angular velocity. This is nothing but angular displacement by time length. For one complete rotation, it requires t time, or time period. In one complete rotation, it is making an angle 2 pi radians. So 2 pi by t will be the formula of the angular velocity. So just now, we discussed certain idea about uniform circular motion. Now let us move on to non-uniform circular motion. Now let us move on to the non-uniform circular motion. Non-uniform circular motion. Suppose a particle is executing horizontal circular motion such that the magnitude of linear velocity is also changing with respect to time. Magnitude of linear velocity is also changing with respect to time. That means mod v bar is not constant, which means that there is a change in v value with respect to time. That means there exists some acceleration in tangential direction. Such a motion is called non-uniform circular motion. In non-uniform circular motion, in order to make the particle to move on the circular path, there exists some acceleration towards the center, like in uniform circular motion. That acceleration towards the center is called now, this is tangential acceleration, this is normal acceleration or radial acceleration, you can say. You can call it as tangential acceleration or normal acceleration. This is called a radial acceleration. Along the radius is acting. So along this direction you have tangential acceleration, along this direction you have radial acceleration. There exists a resultant vector for these two, that is called net acceleration. As you know that radius and tangent both are perpendicular to each other. Whenever you want the net acceleration, square root of tangential acceleration plus radial acceleration, you should take into consideration. Tangential acceleration or normal acceleration can be calculated by taking dv by dt. And radial acceleration, it is towards the center of the circle, which is given by the general formula r omega square r v square. By substituting these two here, you will get the net acceleration in non-uniform circular motion. So these ideas of circular motion are useful in various concepts like banking of roads. Banking of roads, conical pendulum, like that. We already discussed those ideas in our regular class. We just go through those ideas once again. For example, if I want to see the banking of roads, the basic idea I will explain here. Why should we bank a road? Whenever there is a curved road, if the vehicle is moving on the curved road, so its direction is gradually changing, leads to the development of some centripetal force. The centripetal force should be balanced by some other force, like frictional force. If the balance between them is not there, so the vehicle may get skidded away. To avoid this problem, we do banking for roads. First of all, let us see one example. Here is a vehicle which is moving with a linear velocity v, but it is taking a turn on this curved road. Due to the variation in the direction of the linear velocity of the vehicle, there exists some centripetal force towards the center of the circle, which should be counterbalanced by a force like frictional force between the tires and the road. As you know, if m is the mass of the vehicle, m is square by r will be the centripetal force acting. The centripetal force m is square by r must be balanced by frictional force. Frictional force is given by coefficient of friction into normal reaction. Normal reaction is given by mg. So mv square by r is equal to mu mg. Mm gets cancelled. So v square is equal to mu rg. V is equal to square root of mu rg. Here mu is the coefficient of friction. So this is the maximum safe speed with which a vehicle can move on a curved road. If it moves with a speed greater than this, what will happen? The centripetal force value gets increases. So it may not be counterbalanced by the frictional force. Frictional force will have some fixed value. So then there is a possibility for skidding of the vehicle. So to avoid this problem, we need to do some banking of the road. Banking of the road is nothing but elevating the outer edge of the road as compared to inner edge through certain angle. Elevating the outer edge of the road as compared to inner edge of the road through some angle is called banking of the road. In case of banking, if the vehicle is moving on this banked road, having certain mass, it's moving with velocity v, then what will happen? There exists the weight of the vehicle mg onwards. As it is moving on covered path, it is balanced by some mg square by r. and frictional force will be acting in this direction. And for equilibrium, we need to resolve the normal reaction. Normal reaction will be like this. Normal reaction can have two components, one component like this, another component like this. If this is theta, this will be theta. So here I am cos theta will be there, here, and sin theta will be there. So n cos theta is balanced by n g. N sin theta is balanced by this frictional force, which must be only square by r. If I take the ratio n sin theta by n cos theta, m is square by r by m g. So tan theta is equal to v square by r g. Tan theta is equal to v square by r g. This is the angle through which you can bank the road given by this equation. Then you can design a safe speed for the vehicle to take a turn on this curved road. And skidding of the vehicle due to overspeed can be eliminated by maintaining this safe speed. Once you go through these ideas in your 11th class regular classwork and try to solve problems based on them. Similarly, we discussed about conical pendulum. Even in case of conical pendulum, we use the concept. Conical pendulum means concept of centripetal force and centrifugal. This is a simple pendulum. If you make this simple pendulum to move on a circular path like this, such a pendulum which is making some angle theta here, at semi vertex angle theta, the pendulum is making some circular motion on a horizontal plane. Such a pendulum is called conical pendulum. In case of conical pendulum, if you want to calculate the time period, so here mg is the weight of the ball in the normal direction. Here tension T in the string will be like this. Here, as it is moving in a circular path, some centrifugal force will come into play. So this tension can have two components. This is one component of the tension. As it is theta, this will be theta. This is T cos theta. This is T sin theta. This T sin theta is acting as centripetal force. Here M sin theta is acting as centripetal force, which should be counterbalanced by the frictional force, which is nothing but mg square by r. So m sin theta takes the role of this centripetal force, has to be balanced by centrifugal force like frictional force. So similarly here, the tension can have a component in this direction towards the center of the circle acting as centripetal force, which should be counterbalanced by centrifugal force like mg square by r here, where r is the radius of the path over which it is moving. So L is the length of the pendulum and the radius of the path, this is also theta. So radius of the path you can estimate by taking a rectangle triangle here. sin theta is equal to opposite side by hypotenuse r by n. Here for equilibrium of this particle t constant must be equal to mg, t sin theta must be equal to mv square by r, then tan theta is equal to v square by rg. When theta is small, is v square by r. When theta is small, sin theta can be taken as theta. Even tan theta can also be taken as theta. So by using that, you can take the time period calculation here. You substitute v is equal to r omega. So r square omega square will come. R and omega square will be there in the numerator. R omega square by g. Omega can be taken as two pi by t whole square. When theta is small, sin theta is approximately equal to theta, which is approximately equal to tan theta. So r by n is equal to r by g into 2 pi by t whole square. R is g by l over rho is equal to 2 pi by t. T is equal to 2 by 2 L by G. If theta is considerable, if theta is considerable, we should not take this approximation here. Sin theta is equal to theta, that is equal to tan theta, cannot be taken. Then this part will have some different structure. So 2 pi by t whole square is equal to g tan theta by r. Here h is the height, let me take point here. So tan theta is equal to r by h. So 2 pi by t is equal to square root r g by r into r by h. R out it cancels. So t is equal to 2 by root h by g. And if you take cos theta here, cos theta is h by l. H can be taken as l cos theta. 2 by root l cos theta by g is the time period of self-independence. Based on this, so many problems are there, we need to solve them. The only thing what you should remember is, whenever you want to keep a particle at equilibrium at a particular location, the normal reaction or tension is to resolve it into two components. One component is providing the necessary centripetal force, which has to be counterbalanced by some suitable centrifugal force. So T sin theta must be equal to m square by r. T cos theta must be equal to mg. If theta is very small, cos 0 is 1, 2 pi root mg. That's what we discussed earlier. If theta is considerable, this is the form of the calculated time. So likewise, we can solve problems based on horizontal circular motion. Here you should understand about the normal acceleration, the radial acceleration, and the net acceleration. And also, you should understand the concept of centripetal force, centrifugal force, and the usage of these centripetal centrifugal forces in case of various examples like banking of roads and conical pendulum, etc. So try to revise all these ideas and try to solve problems based on them. Let me discuss some applications related to that. Let us solve one application here. Question. The ratio of angular velocities, find the ratio of angular velocities of hours hand of your clock and self rotation of earth. It's a simple question. So problem based on angular velocity. Angular velocity is 2 pi by time period. Time period is the time taken for one complete rotation. So you need the ratio of angular velocity of hours hand, angular velocity of earth. It is 2 pi by time period of hours hand. Hours hand will take one rotation in 12 hours. So its time period is 12 hours. So 2 pi by time period of earth is 24 hours. So 24 hours is the time period for the earth. So ratio of the angular velocities, if you take, that is 2:1. That is the simple solution for this question. One more question, let's see. A car moves with a velocity of a car moves with a velocity of 45 km/h. Angular velocity of its wheel. They are given the linear velocity of the vehicle, that is 45 km/h. Whenever you want to convert km/h into m/s, by 18 you should multiply. Whatever you want, you can use. Angular velocity of the wheel, you know that V is equal to R omega, that implies omega is equal to 3 by R. You are provided with the diameter of the wheel. Diameter of the wheel is 50 centimeters, means radius is equal to diameter by 2, that is 25 centimeters, that is 1 by 4th meter. 100 centimeters is equal to 1 meter, so 25 centimeters means 1 by 4th meters. So linear velocity is 45 into 5 by 18 by radius is 1 by 4. Then answer you will get 45 into 5 into 4 by 18 simple applications of circular motion and angular velocity. One more example, let us see. Here, the question, it says, the angle turned through by a disc, the angle turned through by a disc in time interval t is given by theta is equal to at plus bt square, where a comma b are constants, find its angular velocity. Very simple question. Angular velocity is rate of angular displacement d theta by dt, that is nothing but d by dt of, here theta is a function of time given by at plus bt square. So a is a constant, d by dt of t, b is a constant, d by dt of t square, a into derivative of t with respect to t1, b into 2t. So a plus 2bt is the form of her angular velocity of the particle during its motion. Similarly, one more question. The acceleration of an athlete running at 36 kilometers per hour
When negotiating a turn of radius 25 meters is when negotiating a turn of radius 25 meters is so when athlete is moving on a circular track of radius 25 meters the simple idea he possesses some acceleration called centripetal acceleration is nothing but v square by r so he is executing the motion with speed 36 kilometers per hour that is equal to 36 into 5 by 18 that is 10 meters per second on substituting 10 here and radius 25 here answer will be 4 meter per second square that is the centripetal acceleration of the athlete while he is negotiating the given turn so in this way a simple application based on the formula what we learned we can do one more question a curved road of 50 meter radius is banked at certain angle for a given speed If the speed is to be doubled, keeping the same banking angle. The radius of curvature of the road is to be changed. Is dash. This is the question. We don't want to change the angle of banking and we designed the road for a particular speed. Initial radius of curvature of the road is 50 meters. So final radius of curvature we need to find. We should keep the angle of banking as constant. Initial speed of the vehicle is suppose v the final speed it should support is twice the initial speed so what is the new radius of curvature related to this we know that tan theta is equal to v square by rg is the general formula for banking of road so in the first case the value is given by v square by r1g in the second case v dash square by r2g since we are keeping theta as constant tan theta is also constant so gg gets cancelled So final radius of curvature by initial radius of curvature is equal to final velocity by initial velocity whole square. Final velocity is twice the initial velocity by v whole square. That is vv gets cancelled 4. So r2 is equal to 4 times of r1. That is 4 times of r1 is 50 meters. So 200 meters. You need to change the radius of curvature from 50 meters to 200 meters to make the vehicle to move at the same safe speed without changing the angle of banking. The final radius should be 4 times of initial radius of curvature of the road. This is the solution for the given problem. Now let us move on to the next problem. The next problem, it is given like this. It was given in IIT 1987. So a spotlight S moves in a horizontal plane with a constant angular velocity of 0.1 radians per second. The spotlight P moves along a wall at a distance of 3 meters when theta is equal to 45 degrees the velocity of the spot is this is the question. So this is the horizontal plane. This is the spotlight S, which is located at a distance h from the wall. And the spotlight is moving with angular velocity (0.1) radians per second. So the wall is located at a distance of 3 meters. So its lighting is falling here. When the spotlight gets rotated while it is making 45 degrees angle here, the new position of the spotlight is here. This is the initial position, this is the final position of the spotlight. So at this moment, what is the velocity of the spot? At this moment, what is the velocity of the spotlight? That is the question. The solution is simple. Suppose this distance is x, and let me take this angle as theta. So once it is 45, obviously it is also 45, so it is also theta only. So you can take tan theta here, tan theta equal to x by h implies x is equal to h tan theta. You want velocity of the spot. So velocity of the spot is nothing but change in position of the spot. So nothing but dx by dt I need. So d by dt of h tan theta. H is the distance between the spotlight and the lighting containing wall. So h is constant. For tan theta, the derivative is secant square theta, and again for the theta derivative is d theta by dt. H is equal to secant square theta d theta by dt. So this is the velocity of the spot. So v is equal to h secant square theta into d theta by dt means omega. So here h they gave as 3 meters. So secant square theta is 45 degrees. We need angular velocity. Already it is also provided, 0.1. So that is 0.3 into secant square 45. Secant 45 is root 2, secant square 45 is 2. So 0.6 meter per second. 0.6 meters per second is the answer for the given question. So very, very simple. Initially the spotlight is here. As the spotlight is rotating with angular velocity, the location of the spotlight is changing like this. When it is making an angle theta is equal to 45 degrees, what is the velocity of this spot, they are asking. So the velocity of the spot can be calculated by using the simple mathematical trigonometric method and some differentiation concept. So the answer for this question is 0.6 meters per second. I hope you understood what I discussed. Let me go with the next question. As per this question, a motor car is traveling at 30 meters per second on a circular track of radius 450 meters. It is increasing its speed at a rate of 2 meters per second. Second square. Then acceleration is, so here motor car is traveling at linear speed they gave, 30 meters per second on a circular track of radius they gave 450 meters and increasing its speed at a rate, that means dv by dt, nothing but normal acceleration or tangential acceleration they gave, 2 meter per second square. as it is moving in a circular path, it is provided with some centripetal acceleration. So that is v square by r, that is 30 square by 450. 30 into 30 by 450, 0, 0 gets cancelled. This will go for 2 times. So 2 meter per second square is centripetal acceleration. And already we calculated normal acceleration. So net acceleration is given by square root of, net acceleration is given by square root of tangential acceleration square plus radial acceleration square. As we discussed earlier, when particle is in non-uniform circular motion, it is having centripetal acceleration toward the center, normal acceleration, ORR, tangential acceleration like this. So net acceleration will be somewhere like this. As these two are perpendicular to one another, net acceleration is given by square root of tangential acceleration square plus radial acceleration square, that is 2 square plus 2 square, so that is 2 root 2. 2 root 2 meter per second square is the net acceleration, and the direction of the net acceleration is given as shown in figure. Here only they asked magnitude. So the magnitude is given by 2 root 2 meter per second square. Let me go to solve one more question. A motorcycle is traveling on a curved track. Of radius 500 meters. The coefficient of friction between the tires and the road is 0.5. The maximum speed to avoid skidding is, this is the question. So very simple. As we discussed earlier, whenever a vehicle is moving on a curved track, it is provided with some linear velocity v like this. So towards the center, some force is acting called centripetal force. Here the friction between the tires and the vehicle is acting as centripetal force, which is to be counterbalanced by v square by r. So frictional force is providing the necessary centripetal force for the motion of vehicle, whose value must be equal to mv square by r. Frictional force means coefficient of friction into normal reaction, that is equal to mv square by r. Normal reaction is mg mv square by r. Mm gets cancelled, v is equal to root mu rg is the safe speed with which a vehicle can move on a curved road without having a skid. Square root of coefficient of friction, they gave 0.5. Radius of the road, they gave 500. and acceleration due to gravity, you can take 9.8. So on simplification it is 250 into 9.8. Approximately, if we consider this as 10, it will become 2500, approximately 50 meters per second is the maximum safe speed of the vehicle, such that it can move without skidding. So this is the solution for this question. Let me move on to the next question. Two particles of masses M1 and M2 are moving in concentric horizontal circles of radii R1 and R2 respectively. Such that their periods are same. The ratio of centripetal accelerations is 2 particles are having masses M1 and M2 and they are moving on circles of radii R1 and R2. Centripetal accelerations ratio you are required to find. Both are moving with same period. So centripetal acceleration is given by R omega square, R into 2 pi by t whole square. So R into 4 pi square by t square. As I said, they are having same periods, so time period is same, 4 pi is constant, so centripetal acceleration is proportional to the radius. So centripetal acceleration of the first particle to second particle is corresponding to R1 by R2. So centripetal accelerations are exactly in the ratio of R1 by R2. So this is the solution for this question. I hope everybody understood the problems what I discussed so far. One more problem, let me discuss here. The question, it says, when the road is dry, the coefficient of friction is mu. The maximum speed of the car The maximum speed of the car in a circular path is (10 meters per second). If the road becomes wet, now the coefficient of friction is mu by 2. The maximum speed permitted is 2 square root of μrg. Here radius of the road we are not going to change. Acceleration due to gravity is also fixed. So maximum speed is proportional to root mu. So V1 by V2 can be written as square root of mu 1 by mu, that is square root of initial coefficient of friction is mu, final coefficient of friction is mu by 2. So it is root 2. So initial speed, they gave it as 10. The final speed we require to find, that is like this. So V2 is equal to 10 by root 2, that is 5 root 2 meter per second. This is the maximum speed which is permitted in case of wet road. In case of dry road, the maximum speed is 10. In case of wet road, the maximum speed is 5 root 2. It's very, very simple. By knowing the formula and the concept behind the formula, we can solve any kind of question. Thank you.